a huge political figure who has never yet spoken at our conference. A cabinet minister, privy councillor, chief whip in the House of Lords, and an entrepreneur. One of the great political figures of the last 20, 30 years. Ladies and gentlemen, please give an enormous welcome to the Right Honourable the Lord Hesketh.
Steve, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great privilege to be here today, and I'm going to do something very uncharacteristic. I'm going to finish and end with two separate poems, and particularly in this city, from which the Chamberlain family and the Industrial Revolution was based, which provided the prosperity until the arrival of Gordon Brown. It's quite a special country to live in. Before, history never repeats itself, but history can provide useful lessons. And there is no question that the disaster of the Versailles Conference in 1919 led to a total and complete catastrophe on the streets of Berlin in 1945. This poem was written by Albert Haushofer, who shared a desk with a leading member of the Nazi Party at the university. He wrote it in the Moerdijk prison before he got hung from a meat hook in 1944. And it reflects on what happens if you become a total pacifist and a total appeaser. I bear lightly that which the court will call my guilt, the planning and concerns. A criminal I would be had I not planned for the future of the nation from the sense of my own duty. Therefore I am guilty, but not in the way that you think. I shall have earlier recognized my duty. I should have more sharply called evil, evil. I reined in my judgment too long. I indict myself in my own heart. I have long betrayed my conscience. I have lied to myself and to others. I knew early on the whole course of the disaster. I did warn, but not enough or clearly. And today I know what I was guilty of. Today, luckily, we have in this country one party, our party. Our party. Which is led by the only leader of any party of consequence in this country who is not a member of the political establishment. Yeah. He is also a man who trades in the truth rather than soft words and lies. Now, to be in Birmingham, when we are effectively in a slump, it's a good moment to reflect on Neville Chamberlain. Neville Chamberlain gets a poor press because of Munich and keeping this country out of the war. What people forget, and I'm lucky enough that my grandfather was his parliamentary private secretary, is what he achieved as Chancellor of the Exchequer, which was while America went into a second slump, we didn't. And the reason we didn't go into a second slump is that he made a number of decisions, one of which was rearmament, because that provided a great deal of employment. He also overruled the Air Staff when they all said they wanted to have bombers, and he said he didn't know anything about military matters, but he did know we lived on an island, so it was probably more important to have fighters to protect us before we had bombers to go and beat somebody else up. He also instigated the financing of the home chain radar. Those two decisions mean that we can all sit in this hall today free men and women within the constrictions of the European Court of Human Rights. In fact, it's fair to say that the European Court of Human Rights is probably both in financial and destructive terms the equal of the Luftwaffe in 1940. It's also terrific to be in Birmingham, which is a city of renaissance. This week in The Economist, the figures were published which show that more night shifts are being put on in the British car industry than any other car industry in Europe, including Germany. Many of those plants surround this great and fantastic building, which represents the vision of the men who created the Industrial Revolution. Our enemy is the establishment. The establishment still believe in a modern version of pacificism and appeasement. And that is why they constantly talk about protecting Europe from itself. Well, we went through this from 1919 to 1945, and we're going through something very similar again. We now have three countries which don't have any form of elected politician ruling them, and we are no doubt going to have more. We have 54% unemployment in Spain among the youth, which is much more worryingly, 25% unemployment generally in Spain. All of this is the key for a complete and catastrophic event, which I believe is going to arrive sooner rather than later. If you listen to the usual loons on Channel 4, John Snow, Can I Help You? At the BBC, they constantly talk about the French Revolution and 1917 in Russia. Well, Russia was not then a civilized country and is not today a civilized country. And in the words of the late Chewin Lai, when asked what he thought about the French Revolution, he said, it's too early to tell. The revolution that I believe is far more relevant to what is happening, for example, in Catalonia today, and may shortly happen in northern Italy, and certainly may happen in France, this great European-wide revolution of 1848. That was a very dangerous revolution. It succeeded in part and failed in others. But that's what we should be looking for. The whole of the population of Europe is becoming progressively disenchanted with a political class who have the total lack of ability to A, tell the truth, and B, deliver anything other than soft-talk and language. And really, the lunatics are now in charge of the asylum. We have Senor Barroso.
Who's he?
I think he comes from Portugal, a country noted for its distinguished military record. 600 years ago, who announced to my absolute amazement that Lady Ashton is going to be the new Duke of Wellington of the European Army. Lady Ashton, I think, has missed 21 out of the last 29 ministerial meetings in Brussels. There clearly has absolutely no idea what's going on whatsoever. She sends her assistant, who is a Spaniard, but he's not allowed to talk, so I don't quite know what his job is. And to be perfectly honest, if Walt Disney was still alive, rather than making very expensive cartoons, all he'd have to do is make docudramas about Europe, and they'd be the greatest comedy hits in the world. Now, returning to what Neville Chamberlain did, my job, if it is that, within this great party, is to have a view on defence procurement. And I just thought I'd run you through a few items. We face a financial crisis in this country, which the government has really not done very much to address. And now it appears the backsliding is in progress, which today's papers are to believe, and Mervyn King says it's okay for George Osborne to go backsliding. It is worth remembering that, of course, Mervyn King was one of the 365 distinguished economists who wrote Margaret Thatcher and told her she got it all wrong. So I'm not sure whether or not his provenance stands up too much inspection. The problem we face is that to build a new weapon system of any kind takes about 20 years from inception to delivery. So what we must do is use what we have and make it work. There are a number of options which are within already existing budgets that would hugely increase the power of this country. If we abandon Trident, double the number of astute submarines, arm them with nuclear-tipped cruise missiles, put British-built marinized Typhoons onto our new carriers, which will be there around 5 years before the famous F-35, also armed with nuclear-tipped cruise missiles, we would have a formidable ability, and we could do it at a price that would also be affordable, and it would keep factories from here to the north of England, to Scotland and Yards, as far north as precise, busy as hell for the next 15 years. Who are deeply concerned about the proposed merger of EADS and British Aerospace. And they have absolutely every right to be. The first question, which I find very confusing in this whole proposition, is that I believe that it's only a few months ago that the chairman of British Aerospace received an award for transparency and lack of corruption by the company, which I have to tell you includes the abolition of having any representatives of salesmen in any country, which is maybe why they're not selling very much. Now, the same company, the same board of directors, now think that it's a good idea to try and do a merger with EADS, who are under very close inspection by the serious fraud office, concerning a contract called GPT valued at £2 billion in Saudi Arabia. Now maybe I'm reading from the wrong piece of paper, but it strikes me that this is a pretty odd state of affairs. The second is it is absolutely impossible for any respectable government to sign a deal which allows other governments to have some form of veto, i.e. France and Germany. The last point, and one that none of the journalists have referred to, but being a bit of an old techie, I can, is that if this merger goes through, it will require the French to basically scrap the Rafale jet. Now that's a bit like asking the French to scrap the TGV, which, mind you, I use it quite a lot, and it's getting dirtier and dirtier. But maybe that's a protest by the SNCF Rail Union against Mr. Hollande, but I think they all voted for it, so I find that hard to believe. It's just getting old, and it doesn't make any money. I once saw the head of SNCF, who I happen to know. I said, how many of your routes make money? He said, Alexander, that's a very simple answer to that question. One, Paris to the Côte d'Azur. The whole of the rest of that system, rather similar to the proposed London to Birmingham will get you there 7 minutes quicker, or maybe 15 if it's a good day, proves that it is a complete and utter waste of time. Incidentally, the TGV has so far cost the French taxpayer 50 billion. And as we live in an age where every single saver and pensioner in this country has been totally screwed, it's time to stop, and it's time to stop engaging in vanity. Yeah. And by God, we've seen enough of it. I returned to the site of Union part where I started. There was a parish pastor in Dahlhelm, suburb of Berlin, who got shot by the SS in the winter of 1944. His name was Martin Niemöller. He also wrote a poem, and it speaks a lot about the problems that we face in Europe. First they came to the communists, and I did not speak out because I was not a communist. Then they came to the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came to the Jews. I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak out for me. Without Nigel Farage, reforming and turning this party into a truly potent political force change in this country, I would not have joined. Having said that, having joined this party was the greatest day of freedom I've ever experienced in my political life. Thank you.